Good afternoon. I assume it's afternoon where you are. I apologies that I can't be with you in person, but thank you very, very much for inviting me to your Neuro Days, Brain and Art in Cetinje. I hope the weather is wonderful. As you know, I am the Professor of Neurology at Barts in London, and I spend almost all my time doing multiple sclerosis, either research or clinical. And the following presentation is going to be framed as a series of questions I've been asked by your hosts, and I'll try and answer them in the next 30 minutes. So the first question is, did I know, that the former British Embassy in Cetinje is now a music academy? And to be honest with you, I had no idea. I must admit, I look at that house and it's quite colonial, very pretty. And I'm sure it's been put to former use. I must say, I do have a link to Montenegro that I discovered during COVID-19. And some of you may know who Fitzroy McLean is. He's a British real-life action hero in the war. And as you know, he was a spy and helped Tito and the Yugoslav resistance fight the Nazis. And I'm linked to him in a strange way is that when the COVID-19 epidemic hit the UK, there was a shortage of PPE, personal protective equipment for doctors and healthcare professionals. And one of my daughter's best friends, who happens to be a clothes studying to be a clothes designer, designed me a pair of designer scrubs, and that's his label. And the important thing is that his name is Johnny McLean, and he happens to be the grandson of Fitzroy McLean. So that's my connection to you. Anyway, the designers at the Central St. Martin's, which is a very famous design school in London, put themselves together during lockdown to make scrubs for NHS staff. And if you go to the website of the Central St. Martin's, you'll see that Johnny McLean's design and his label gets central billing, and that's on the website. Anyway, I've been asked to talk about the art of preserving brain health in the time of COVID-19, and several questions around how the pandemic has evolved and B cell therapies in this space. So the first question I was, what was the evolution with MS treatments during the pandemic? How did our approach to treatment change? And what is the risk of stopping treatment during COVID-19? And you're probably aware the European epicenter when it first emerged was in northern Italy, and the Italians came out of the blocks quite quickly with a series of guidelines, followed very soon after that, literally weeks after that, by the British Association of Neurologists. And they essentially divided up therapies into mainly two categories, those that they considered relatively low risk to continue during the pandemic and only to stop if there was diagnosed infection. And then all the depleting therapies, so that's from anti-CD20 downwards, cladribine, alemtuzumab, HSC, should be delayed and suspended. So there's like this black and white approach to how we manage MS. Now, my personal opinion is, and it doesn't change at all, is when this came out, it was like a knee-jerk response without thinking through the epidemiology of this pandemic. And it was quite clear it was going to last not only a few months or weeks, but possibly years. So we had to have a more pragmatic approach. And so I actually developed an online resource, which is on a website called MS Selfie. And I've created a table that goes through all the features of disease-modifying treatments. And I kind of had a more nuanced approach based on the fact that we're going to have to continue treating patients and managing them because of the risks associated with untreated MS or undertreated MS. And I kind of categorized the therapies into four classes: very low, low, intermediate, and high risk. And I published the second version in a review article in Multiple Sclerosis and Related Disorders. And the concept was that we're going to have to deal with the COVID-19 pandemic, but also treat MS because, people are going to continue to be diagnosed or potentially diagnosed with MS. They're still going to have active disease and they're going to be treated. And we have been, as a community, pushing for a more proactive approach to managing ACE. In other words, treating to a target of need and going beyond and preventing end organ damage, using our disease-modifying treatments to prevent damage and to optimize long-term outcomes. And so this concept of time as brain shouldn't be thrown away. You know, MS should be treated proactively, and we shouldn't compromise on the way we manage MS. And I think this has shown to be the way we should do things. And I've had some serious consequences. Just to give you an example, we had one of the patients who just decided on their own to stop their fingolimod treatment. And they came in with quite severe rebound and a spinal cord relapse at around about 2 months after stopping fingolimod treatment, completely independent of us. Similarly, we had a patient from, not from our center, that contacted me via my blog, and they had been delayed in natalizumab treatment and had come in also with a brainstem relapse. So we have been seeing quite several unfortunate consequences of delays in treatment. Another patient that I was looking after on the general medical wards, because I was redeployed there, was a lady who had lupus and had CNS lupus. And the decision had been made not to give a cyclophosphamide back in mid-March because of the worry that she'd be immunocompromised. And so they treated her with mycophenolate and steroids, which wasn't sufficient to hold her. Then she came in with Frank's psychosis and an encephalitis. And it took us literally weeks to get her lupus under control. And eventually we had to give a cyclophosphamide. You know, we tried plasma exchange and rituximab, because the mother was then panicking about cyclophosphamide. And eventually we had to, in conjunction with the rheumatologist, treat her with cyclophosphamide. So this issue of changing the way we treat diseases and not managing them proactively is not only MS, but it's in other conditions as well. And the final example I give you is a lady I look after with neuromyelitis optica, and we wanted to treat her with rituximab also in March. And she decided on her own bat to delay her rituximab treatment. And the reason is that she'd broken through on mycophenolate as well, and she came in with a large mid-thoracic spinal cord relapse as a consequence. We had to bring her in. She had two courses of steroids with no improvement, and then we had to plasma exchange her and eventually treat her with rituximab. So I've seen the consequences in a handful of patients of us changing our standard therapeutic approach that we've evolved over decades to treat diseases, not only MS, but other diseases, with quite severe consequences. And now we've put a little study in place to actually analyze our cohort of patients where treatment decisions have been delayed or changed to see if it's had any consequences for patients. And I wouldn't be surprised if those four examples I've just given you are just the tip of the iceberg, and we're going to see a lot worse outcomes as a result of people changing behavior when the actual threat of COVID-19 hasn't been so great. Next set of questions are our key learnings around B-cell therapies and coronavirus infection, about the risks associated with this anti-CD20 and immunosuppression in general, and how safe it is to use anti-CD20 therapies during COVID-19. So this is unpublished, but this data just emerged in the last few weeks. Prior to this, we were making the assumption that anti-CD20 therapies were not associated with any increased risk of getting COVID-19 or not. Then this was from the Swedish registry. It was presented on a webinar about a month ago. And you can see in Sweden, where they don't use much ocrelizumab, but most of their patients are on rituximab, you can see 33%, one in three of their patients in Sweden are on rituximab. And 56% of patients with MS diagnosed with COVID and hospitalized were on rituximab, which is an increased proportion above other DMTs. So in Sweden, being treated with rituximab looks like it increases your risk of getting into hospital or having COVID-19 by about 60%. Now, this probably is ascertainment bias, because I can tell you now that the rituximab-treated patients tend to be mainly urban, mainly in Stockholm. They're younger, and so they may go out more. And also the fact that they're receiving infusions and getting called up for the infusions may result in ascertainment bias, the question being asked by the healthcare professional, have you had COVID-19? So the biases haven't yet been analyzed yet, so this signal may disappear. I think what's important is that the Italians, who've got the most experience, have published their data in Lancet Neurology earlier this year. And this is the first 230-odd cases of MS patients developing COVID-19, and they only had five deaths, which is actually lower than what you'd expect in terms of the background population. And you can see in the top five cases that died, most of them were, four out of five were over 60. They all had progressive disease. Three out of five didn't have any treatment. One had DMF, the other one rituximab. And most of them had comorbidities. So it's now emerging that the risk factor for getting severe COVID-19 and dying from it in the MS population are the same risk factors that are playing out in the general population. And this may be important later on when it comes to screening, shielding or quarantining patients, is that the comorbidities, the older, the more advanced patients are the high-risk patients, not necessarily the ones on disease-modifying treatment. Roche actually published their first 100 cases that have been reported to them, and you can see that 26 out of 100 patients had serious COVID-19, in other words, requiring hospital admission, and only 5% had critical infections, in other words, were life-threatening. None of them died. And I think, you know, this particular proportion, 26%, 5%, is kind of what you'd expect in the background population. The one caveat here is that the MS population would be younger than the general population, so this may be higher than is expected. But again, the data is what it is, and so these are self-reported cases from the MS community, so you'd also get reporting bias here. The kind of patients that are going to get reported to Roche are likely to be the ones hospitalized with more serious disease. So until we get population-based studies that are looking for people with MS who have had relatively mild or asymptomatic COVID-19 in the community and get the denominator to be representative of the general population, we can't really interpret this data. But I think it's overall reassuring that it doesn't look like people on an anti-CD20 therapy are at excessive risk of getting COVID-19 or severe COVID-19. And the mortality signal is not there. This is not enough numbers to say if it increases mortality, but it's possibly going to be unlikely. I think we do know now that what controls the actual viral infection, particularly in the first phase, is not B cells, but it's the innate immune system, neutrophils, macrophages, and the cytotoxic CD8 positive T cells. These are responsible for viral clearance. Then only with secondary exposure do you require CD4 cells and antibody-mediated immunity. And this is just a case, for example, showing this. This is a case that was a Chinese lady who was in Australia that was interrogated. And you can see, if you look on the graph here, I just want to get the pointer up. You can see, so there was a pre-symptomatic phase, and then she presented to the emergency department, okay? And you can see that the viral shedding drops off. So by day 7, she hasn't got any virus anymore, and the antibodies only really start to emerge around about day 7. And if you look at antibody risk-secreting cells, they only appear about day 7, whereas the cytotoxic T lymphocytes are probably already there. And what's interesting is the monocyte counts drop in the peripheral blood, probably recruited into the end organ, into the lung to fight the infection. So you're getting viral clearance and improvement in symptoms, okay, prior to there being a significant B cell response. So we don't think B cells are essential for clearing the virus. And we know that because there's been two patients who have X-linked agammaglobulinemia from Italy. So these people have got no B cells. They're born with a hereditary condition that prevents them from developing B cells. And both these patients who got COVID-19 recovered. And so that's actually another bit of reassurance that B cell immunity is probably not essential for recovery from the viral complications. Just to say to you, I've now on version 6 of my table, which you can read if you want to on mshealthy.org. And I actually have, based on the Swedish data and a survey done in Iran showing a similar thing, that people on anti-CD20 therapy, that's also rituximab, ocrelizumab is not available in Iran. Most of the MS patients there would be on rituximab. I'm just saying that anti-CD20 therapy is probably not an intermediate risk, it's potentially a higher risk based on that data, and we now need to wait for registry data or big data analyses to perform. Other things that I've added to the table include things about the need to shield and also potentially getting ready for a vaccine if it emerges, what I call vaccine readiness. And I explain on this column some of the subtleties of each of the disease-modifying treatment. I don't have time to go through this table in detail. If you want to read it, it's available online for you to read. Now, this table is only really relevant if you're in a major epidemic and you've got lots of cases, because this has to be put in context of what's happening in your country and in your environment. And I was looking online, and I think the COVID-19 epidemic is almost flattened and gone in Montenegro. Another hypothesis that we're looking at is that when people die and you look at the lungs of people who die from severe COVID-related complications, the adult respiratory distress syndrome, the lungs are full of immunoglobulin and complement activation. So there is this potential for antibody-mediated damage to make the condition worse. And so there is this potential that the immunoglobulin and complement and macrophage activation actually makes you're more likely to get severe disease and dying from it. And if an anti-B cell therapy, I'm not talking about anti-CD20, it could be anti-CD19, a BTK inhibitor, any of our anti-B cell agents, cladribine, alemtuzumab that drop B cells, it may protect you from more severe disease. And that's an hypothesis that's been out there now for a while. Okay, and it may hold true because it's looking like in other disease areas, mild to moderate immunosuppression is not associated with an increased risk of severe disease. So maybe dampening down some of the mechanisms that drive the lung damage may protect people from severe COVID-19. So keep this in mind. It may still emerge that the proportion of patients on an anti-CD20 therapy, for example, may be protected from dying from the condition. This is from the UK anesthetics databases. So this is all the patients admitted to intensive care units during COVID-19. This was actually up until early April. And when you look at the COVID-19 patients, the proportion on immunosuppression was much lower than with other viral pneumonias, mainly influenza. There was about a 4 times lower chance of being on immunosuppression compared to, say, influenza pneumonia that was collected between 2017 and 2019. I'm not talking, these aren't small numbers. These are 2,049 cases versus almost 5,000 patients. And this is highly significant. So this is another indication that maybe immunosuppression, okay, is protective for severe COVID-19. So please keep that in mind. This is your data that I collected online from the John Hopkins Coronavirus Resource Center, and it's quite remarkable how well your country's done. You've only had 326 confirmed cases with 9 deaths, and if you look at this little graph in the bottom right-hand corner, you can see you've actually completely flattened to hardly any cases. So I think you need to look at your own epidemiology and say, actually, in terms of having MS and living in Montenegro, the chance of you getting exposed to coronavirus and getting COVID-19 is extremely low. So all those issues and anxieties around the risk on disease-modifying therapy are probably not relevant to your country, not relevant to your country. And I was asked about a second surge. How can we ensure the best treatment for our I don't think it's applicable to your country. It looks like you've got things buttoned. And it's unlikely you're going to have a second surge. And even if you have a second surge, you know, all you can do is tell patients to be a little bit more vigilant rather than not treat them. So I think you have to go back to treating MS the way you want to treat MS. I am worried about the impact of COVID on the management of MS patients, because in our country, we've had to reconfigure our services to deal with the coronavirus pandemic. So we are got diagnostic patients on diagnostic pathways, they're not finished. They need LPs and MRI scans. So we've got a big backlog in our country in terms of diagnosing MS, big backlog in terms of starting people on treatment. And there has been interruption to treatment in a large number of patients. So that has to be unwound. And I'm not sure how quickly it's going to be unwound. Okay. And I suspect the hidden costs of not or under-treating MS as a result of COVID-19 is going to be quite substantial when we start analyzing the data. So yes, COVID-19 has had a massive impact across the NHS. I'm glad for you as a country that it hasn't had a big impact. So your healthcare system seems to be back up and running as you want it. And so the impact in your country won't be prolonged, but in the UK, it's going to be terrible. We've had an excess mortality independent of COVID-19 related to undertreated myocardial infarctions, pneumonias, etc. And so we're very worried about the impact of COVID-19, not just on MS, but on population health. Now, I sent these slides about a local project. It was done in Montenegro around treating people early versus late. And the important thing was this included 219 people with multiple sclerosis who live in Montenegro. 138 of these patients received their first therapy within 2 years of being diagnosed, so quite early, whereas about a third of them, 81 patients, received their first therapy after 2 years, so had a treatment delay, what we call a lag. And it's quite obvious in terms of being absent from work what a difference it is. You can see, you know, patients who were treated early, okay, much less absenteeism from work compared to people treated later. Now, the obvious thing is, yeah, is what's driving this, and it's not a surprise what's driving that. This also shows you that people treated early, and this is using a metric in terms of performance at work, were actually performing better than normal, which is surprising, but maybe they're just more motivated to keep their jobs compared to those that were treated late. They're underperforming compared to the general population. Similarly, quality of life. So the, you know, when you actually break it up into different epochs, first 6 months, 6 months to 1.5 years, 1.5 to 3, 3 to 6, and 6 to 10 years, you can see quality of life deteriorates dramatically. And so another indication that the earlier you treat this disease based on your own data, the better the outcome is in terms of individuals' quality of life. And finally, when you actually put some figures onto this, you can see with absenteeism and presenteeism, this is at work, people that are treated early make you cost much less than people treated late. So there is an economic impact, yeah. And the modeling of this at, to a population level, is the cost for Montenegro caused by incapacity for work within MS patients who start therapy within 2 years is almost 10 million euros. So this is quite a large amount of money for your country. And so this is not new. I would call this derivative. So this is data that's out there already for the European Union. This is just a deep dive into your own local population. And so the total cost of incapacity for work caused by MS in Montenegro is around 16.4 million euros per annum. So that's another reason for you as neurologists and MS experts is to get the message across to your healthcare systems, to your policymakers and your politicians, that they need to give you the resources to diagnose MS as soon as possible and to start treatment as soon as possible. And the concept here is prevent. In other words, time is brain. You don't want the disability. And you've probably seen this paper that was published in 2017 from Giselle Cobalt, just showing you how bad MS is for European people. And we can see the unemployment rate compared to the general population. And when you get to an EDSS-3, almost 50% of people with MS in Europe are unemployed, compared to about 11% in the general population. That's an enormous difference. Now, what you've got to realize at EDS3, these people aren't physically disabled. So what's driving this is cognitive issues. And we know that cognition issues are a big, big problem for people and come on much earlier than physical disability. The thing about cognitive issues, people don't complain about cognitive issues because they compensate for them by just thinking harder and doing more mental activity. And it comes at the consequences of fatigue, depression and anxiety. So hidden in this figure are all the drivers of early unemployment. Another reason to treat early and effectively. And so this is actually why we've got our brain health initiative, Time is Brain, simply because the earlier you treat this, the better the long-term outcome. So please keep that in mind. And I put up cognition here because you can see, the longer you go with MS, the more cognitive impairment you find. So that you can see as you go from year 5 to year 10, the proportion of patients with cognitive impairment increases. Perhaps about half the patients will become cognitively impaired. So I'm beginning to think of MS as a cognitive disease more than a physical disabling disease, and you've got to treat early to prevent this. And our lessons come from rheumatology. The rheumatologists have shown, and they actually evolved this thing, treat the target, and we now treat the target of no evident disease activity. I think we need to go beyond that and try and prevent end organ damage. And this is an end organ rheumatoid hand. And you can see on the right there, this particular patient has had joint replacements. Now, we in the MS space, we just can't rely on replacing the brain and spinal cord. It's not possible. So we have to actually think differently about our treatments. And I'll urge you to think of disease-modifying treatments about being preventive. In other words, by hitting hard and early, preventing damage protects patients from the consequences downstream. There's no point in trying to treat this disease when people have become disabled, already have cognitive impairment. It's too late. So we really need to think about how we diagnose and treat much, much earlier. And I'll leave it there. And I would like to thank you very much for the invitation, and I hope you've enjoyed this. And if you have any questions, please come to the MS blog, ask questions, or the MS Selfie website. There's a little section there for asking questions, or just drop me an email, and I'll hopefully get back to you with any questions. Enjoy the rest of the conference.